You skinflint old bastard.
Clearly states, rest in peace. Why am I not allowed any peace?
Bring everyone. You know you're more than welcome.
Merry Christmas.
Mr. Cratchit? Mr. Bob? Will you come tomorrow?
No, I'm afraid I can't tomorrow. Work.
Work, my love? Tomorrow?
Dad, you forgot this.
I'm not on this, silly.
No, I didn't forget old Timmy. I saw he was offering an extra prayer and I let him be.
Well, poor cat that died. Rest in peace.
Rest in peace, my eye. You're chasing mice around St. Peter's.
Tomorrow's Christmas Eve. You promised this year you'd stand up to him.
Come on, Cratty. We'll be a fine do tomorrow. Children in charge, blind man's buff and all that. Bring the whole tribe.
I'm sorry.
I'm afraid my husband worked for a man with an ice pick for a heart.
Ah, of course, you toil for old Scratch, don't you? My condolences. Oh, well, so be it. Merry Christmas, Cratchit tribe. Excuse me.
So be it. Year after year.
Linda, come on.
We get wet and catch his death.
Ooh. It's nearly Christmas, Mama.
Yes.
Three.
The smudge is from the fourth lump, I have no doubt. The smudge is from kindness.
Merry Christmas to you too, Mr. Scrooge.
I've left an important document to be copied three times before day's end. One for London, one for Birmingham, one for Manchester.
Three, not four, sir.
Well?
Today appears to be a day for four. Not three.
Ah, you mean the extra lump of coal I gave you? Well, curse the fourth. Curse gestures. Just make three copies of the letter, and should there be no blots, no smudges, no stains, you may go home. At four.
Mr. Scrooge, I thought we'd agree that today, on account of the day it is, I could go home at three.
I give you an extra lump of coal, and straight away you want to snip an extra hour off the day. Three becomes four, four becomes three. I don't care for your revolutionary mathematics. This is not Paris.
It's frozen, sir.
What is?
My ink. I'll have to thaw it on the fire.
No, that will waste time. You can use mine.
Christmas present, is it, sir?
Oh, please. If it were a Christmas present, I would have wrapped it in ribbons and bows to artificially increase your anticipation. And you would tear it open and gasp and say, "Oh, my lord, a bottle of ink. This is exactly what I've always wanted." And I would shrug and smile and tell you that of all the ink bottles in all the world, this is the one ink bottle I wanted you to have on this most holy and sacred of days. Behold, one day of the year, they all grin and greet each other when every other day they walk by with their faces in their collars. You know, it makes me very sad to see all the lies that come as surely as the snow at this time of year. How many Merry Christmases are meant, and how many are lies? To pretend on one day of the year that the human beast is not the human beast. That it is possible we can all be transformed. But if it were so, if it were possible for so many mortals to look at the calendar and transform from wolf to lamb, then why not every day? Instead of one day good, the rest bad, why not have everyone grinning at each other all year and have one day in the year when we are all beasts and we pass each other by? Why not turn it around?
Yes, sir. Yes, you could call that day of beastliness Scrooge Day, in honor of its inventor.
Yes, why not? It would be the one day where everyone is free to tell all those around them exactly what they really think of them.
Well, I think every clerk in England would report for work on that day, sir.
in order that they could tell their employer the awful truth of what is in the heart.
Yes.
The truth without ribbons and bows. What do you say?
I say, sir, in all my 10 years of working here, you never bothered to explain your philosophy before. I'm quite flattered, sir, that today, of all days, you should share the machinery of your great logic with a mere clerk.
It isn't logic, Cratchit.
Well, then, sir, what is it?
Mind out for the word litigation. You have a habit of spelling it wrongly.
I spelt it wrongly once. 5 years ago.
Punctual at 7:10 for the past 189 days. With a 7-day hiatus, July 4th to 11th, when no doubt he and his horse were in Margate. Somewhere atrocious. No ink. 3 calls, 15 steps of the horse, 5 turns of the wheel. I need a pencil. New voice. Four calls, 21 steps of the hoof, 9 turns of the wheel. 2 from Chestnut. Oh, damn it. 5 calls, 27 steps of the horse, 11 turns of the wheel. 3 from Chestnut Woman. 5, 27, 11, Rag and Bone. Please pass by. Both of you, please pass by. 4, 5,
yes.
Rag and Bowman's passing. And wants to know if we have any rags or bone or iron.
None. He is just begging a Christmas box. 6.
Sir, are you all right? You don't seem yourself today.
Well, I am myself, always. Please, get on with your work. Last night, I had a dream of chains and furnaces, and I realized when I am alone and I talk out loud, it is still you I am talking to. As if you were not completely gone. But I was at your burial. And I am rational. I placed the coins on your eyes. I saw your coffin lowered. So I have no explanation why I speak out loud to you. Yeah!
Benny Oldhorn and Rick. You miserable bastard.
Six, Ragenbone. Ah, Jacob. Imagine at least where you are, it's quiet.
Of fate. Oh, spirits of life and death. Whoever is in charge of this ill-begotten universe, I'm begging you to free me from this consciousness. Let me rest. Give me darkness. I know my sins were many, but I have repented and repented and repented. Tell me what I must do to make amends. And I will do it. Please. Please tell me this is not hell.
Not quite, Pilgrim.
I have money. 2 pennies. They're yours. Please, let me go. I know you.
You do. I died like a horse of exhaustion. One of your workshops. So many men, women, and children died at your penny-pinching hands. And each one I forged into a link in a chain. The chain you must now wear, Mr. Marley.
What reason? I've been dead a year, why now?
You rang the bell. You offered penance. And since your call was answered... I'd wager the spirits have a little job for you.
Ah!
Done.
Mr. Scrooge.
You've already proved the first two, sir.
Just checking again, Cratchit. Light grows dim. I sense you are angry with me.
Why do you say that?
Because everything on this page is perfect, precise, immaculate, you might say. You got it all right to spite me, to show me.
No, sir, no, to afford you the possibility that since all the work is done correctly and early, I might leave early. Spend the rest of the day with my family.
Your anger made you work quickly, but perfectly. You didn't stop to think that working quickly and perfectly also suits me, the object of your hatred, down to the ground.
I don't hate you, sir. I'm not accustomed to talking about these matters with you. I ask you again, is everything all right with you?
Christmas, it seems, inspires such emotion, good and evidently bad. I feel your eyes burning into me. Imagine you were a violent man. Imagine your pen were a dagger. Imagine I were found dead on Christmas morning. The murder could be laid, too, at the door of the spirit of Christmas, yes?
Mr. Scrooge. Mr. Scrooge, it's now 3:08. My work is complete. If we're back to logic, then logic suggests that my sitting in there idle for no reason, that's the anomaly.
A letter of complaint to the Lord Mayor regarding persistent noise caused by costermongers, gypsies, street musicians, rag and bone men, various other gutter runners. I want this letter written out in duplicate and put in with the last post today. It contains very precise mathematics pertaining to the quantity and frequency of the intrusions. Please be sure to get the numbers correct. I took great pains over them.
Huh. Great pain. Yes, I can see that.
It is not I in curious mood today, Cratchit. It is you, as if you're suddenly careless of your situation.
No, sir. No, I'm not careless of my situation, sir. I know my situation. I have two children and a wife to take care of at a time of high unemployment. One of my children is very sick, sir, and his treatment costs money. I know, sir, I know the narrowness of my situation. And so do you. So do you.
Two copies of that letter should take you nicely up to 4:00.
We'll see.
Here. I was told the spirits have a job for me.
What spirits? What job? Warmth at least. And explanation. And perhaps salvation.
Oh, God. Hello, old friend. Six times we won the Epsom Derby together.
Oh,
Hello!
I saw someone tending this fire. Where are you? Hello?
I have no idea who you are, but why on earth did you just burn my rocking horse?
Because you're next. On the fires, I burn memories and old affections. And the ghosts of Christmas past. Here to smoke out redemption. You have lingered in purgatory for your many sins. If it turns out you can be redeemed, I will rake you out of the flames and blow you cool and deliver you to everlasting and eternal peace.
Understood. Peace is indeed what I seek.
If you want peace, there is a price. And the price is repentance.
If this is about repentance, then I've already repented. I rang a bell. Rang as a consequence of my declared repentance. And the blacksmith...
I don't care. You are not here for your sins alone. Your fate is bound to the soul of Ebenezer Scrooge. It is with him that you profaned the spirit of humanity. Together, you will repay. And together, and only together, can you repent.
So you're saying I should ever be held in purgatory until my friend has also repented.
Then, if you would throw another ewe on the fire, bring me a blanket and a pillow, if such things are allowed, because I am without doubt stuck here for fucking ever. Because that man, that object in the shape of a man, that thing with black ink in his veins, is 94% gravel and rubble, and the rest is his stupid hair. And I know for certain that he will never repent.
Before this Christmas is ash, I must search the heart of Ebenezer Scrooge and see if there's a tender place there. Your fate depends upon it.
Afternoon.
Uncle Ebenezer!
I ran in case you might be closing early.
No, still many things to do. You seem out of breath.
That's because I ran to catch you. And to invite you to dinner tomorrow.
Oh, what's tomorrow?
It's a birthday tomorrow. It's, Our Lord
Jesus Christ's birthday. Now, I know you don't believe in Christmas, but you believe in him, don't you?
No. Nor do I believe in Ali Baba or the magic genie of the lamp. Besides, which liar told you that tomorrow was his birthday?
It's in the Bible.
Another deceit. There is no mention of a date in that book or in any other. And as for those images I see on church walls of three wise men on camels walking in the snow, there's no record of it being winter and no record of there ever being snow in Palestine. Indeed, riding camels in the snow is the very embodiment of the absurdity and the lies which have continued to beget more lies down the centuries during the days now marked 24 and 25.
You believe in fig pudding? And there will be fig pudding.
And there will be fig pudding too in January.
Would you come in January?
No.
Uncle, before she died, my mother said to me, Fred, you must forgive my brother Ebenezer. He's just in pain. A very old pain. Very well. I'll get to my point. Every year I come here and I invite you to dine with myself and my wife, my children, whom you'd never even set eyes upon. This is the last time I'll make such an invitation. Upon my wife's insistence, I will do this no more.
Good. Save you getting all out of breath.
Uncle. Yeah, I will say it because I know it hurts you. Merry Christmas, Uncle Ebenezer. I doubt I'll ever see you again on this earth.
The exact same dates as the coins I put on your eyes when you lay in your coffin. I always look at the dates. They interest me. But how come these same coins are here? Why now?
Add them to your list of intrusive voices, sir.
Done, sir. Finished. 40 minutes left. I assume he has something else for me to fill the time.
Go home.
Home.
Home. Leave my office early and bow down to this absurd season. But please say it's four and set me free. Lie to me and I'll believe you.
Days off, Tim.
You're worse than old Scrooge. If it's exercise you want me to do, why not let me go skating on the pond beyond the yard? I can borrow Belinda's skates.
Ah, so you skate before you can walk, before you can run. Besides, Belinda's skates are broken.
Hi, darling.
Oh, what did you get?
We got a big fat goose.
Wait, two more minutes.
Grumpy daddy.
When did you get home?
Bugger, let me go about 40 minutes early. Very strange mood.
It's Christmas. Let's not talk about him. Not even once.
You seem to despise him even more than I do. Gone, Tim wrote his Christmas letter to your cousin Jack. That's what he wrote. Dear Mr. Levitt, I hope you're well and that there's lots of snow there in America.
Darling, after 7 years, there's no need for Tim to keep on writing letters of thanks to America every single Christmas for eternity.
And why? He did save Tim's life.
Very well. I'll go and post it. I'll catch the last post.
We'll all come with you. And here will do us all some good.
Very well. We'll all go. Tim?
Yes.
Belinda?
Ah, Mr. Scrooge.
Sir, do you have any spare change for an excellent cause?
What cause might that be?
Oh, it's for the welfare of the poor and destitute who suffer greatly at this time of year. Hundreds of thousands in the city are in want of common comforts.
Are there no prisons?
Oh, plenty of prisons.
And the union workhouses, are they still in operation?
I wish I could say they were not.
The treadmill and the poor law.
Well, uncommonly busy since the financial collapse.
But some would rather die than go there.
Then let them die.
All we're asking for, sir, are a couple of penny coins. Do you not have 2 penny coins in your pocket?
Humbug.
I'm not sure if you spelt your cousin's name correctly. Mary, is it Levitt with 2 T's or 1?
It's spelt with 2 T's.
All right. There's Linda. Oh,
you need skates, eh?
That's where last year you said it was spelt with 1 T.
My cousin is now an American. They don't care for teas, they drink coffee.
Merry Christmas.
Oh, Merry Christmas.
This cousin, whose name changes every year, you never mentioned before Tim became sick.
The children are happy here. Stay with them. I'll post the letter and I'll come back.
Who left you here?
Oh.
Apologies, old friend. I'm not quite sure how these things work. I first phoned as your door knocker and you knocked off my chin. Seems fine now.
I understand this must come as a shock.
No. No, because this is not real. This is not real.
There's much I have to tell you about what is real and what is not real. The reality's a decision. I've learnt that. I've been sent by a spirit. A spirit who doesn't care and imagine would relish our failure. But is obliged to seem to try to help.
I didn't need today. This is the result of lightheadedness caused by hunger. I am asleep in this armchair.
Have you forgotten, Ebenezer? I'm already dead. You can't kill me. And if you were to hit me with that thing, then I'll just be very messy for the rest of our conversation. And we have much to discuss. I don't understand you all, but you threw a blanket over a pair of cold black horses. I believe that means there is hope.
Hope of what?
No need for me to explain. You'll meet them soon enough.
Meet who?
The spirits. I've met one, but I'm told there are three.
I have no plans to meet anyone. I want to be alone.
And yet it is Christmas, Ebenezer. Christmas.
Very well. Go out there. They've laid on a little show for you.
And Thompson, a factory in Birmingham which we purchased for pennies and we cut their cloth according to our meanness. The consequences of one's actions always ends up on one's own doorstep. How righteous and scalding we were at the inquest. Remember? Idleness, drunkenness, a lack of common sense on a part of the workforce, we blame them all. And we got the all clear from a judge whose palm are crossed with silver. Look at these chains, Ebenezer. This isn't a fucking game, look. Each link is a man or woman or child who died in our workshops in London, Birmingham, Manchester, Bombay, Batavia.
Wait. Wait, and they were subcontracts.
They have on your...
Enough!
No, it was never enough.
Not for you or for me. And for what? What was the purpose of our gross accumulation? For this. We vandalized the world.
Whatever you are, I should like you to leave my home now.
But when your time comes, there'll be change for you too. And your fate will be to wander the earth with the great weight of your past on your shoulders.
Unless I repent, yes? Humbug, I will say. Repent what, I will say?
The spirit I met has no concern for your soul. Or mine. I want salvation. But in truth, it is up to you.
Bah!
Ebenezer Scrooge. The first of three spirits will come tonight when the clock strikes midnight. The next will come the next night at the same hour. And the third will come the following night, also at midnight. Prepare ye.
A reality so readily banished is not much of a reality. A piece of undigested beef. A lump of uncooked potato. Humbug!
I did as you asked. I called on Ebenezer and I told him he'd be visited by three spirits. And I urged him, I pleaded with him to hear what the spirits had to say. And he replied with one word. I'll spell it for you. H-U-M-B-U-G. And he settled into his chair and then... What's the point? Way anyone could ever soften Scrooge's heart would be with a mincing knife and a cup of warm gravy to make some kind of unpleasant pudding. Let's face it, I'm stuck here forever. And what do you care anyway, eh? So you were just numbers on a list in your celestial inventory.
Nevertheless, having observed this Ebenezer Scrooge, I relish a challenge. I'll show him his most treasured memories and tortured nightmares. And like the many thousand souls before him, he will beg forgiveness. Dublin's fair city, where the girls are so pretty. I once set my eyes on sweet Molly Malone.
Why are you awake, my love?
I'm excited. It will soon be Christmas.
Mary. Is there something you want to tell me? Yeah.
money you received was not sent by some mysterious cousin in America. Who did send it? Why?
Let Christmas be, Bob, please. Just let Christmas be. Listen. It's almost here.
When Christmas is done, if you'll tell me who.
Come, spirit, change me. Try.
Is that you, spirit?
Do ghosts have bells attached to them?
Visitation is over. Time for a celebration. A rat wrapped in a ribbon is no match for reason.
Streets.
awake, are you? Ebenezer! Your little prayers on my behalf were no use. They did me this afternoon. Over tea and biscuits. Did me up proper. They took the lot, every fucking thing! They covered my ass with tallow and set it alight like a cat. What did you say? Please don't make it that he can see me. Oh, I can see. I can see. Oh, I see ye, boy!
What did you say?
Please, not this night.
What night?
The night you were declared bankrupt.
What? You're sorry for me, are you? He's fucking sorry. Hell, you know this. You know that everyone out there, every man, every woman, they're all beasts who care only for themselves, because that is what a human is. It's an inward-looking thing only. This whole world is cock fighting cock, bear fighting dog, hands in your pockets, fingers up your ass. They're trying to take your very kidneys from you. You learn that from this night.
I know that, Father. That I know.
There is no virtue. Look upon me. Everything talk. No mercy shown. I only just made it across the Thames without giving myself up to it. But I continued because I have you and your useless fucking frozen up mother to keep. And your sister to keep too, and a scrubber maid and a sweep. And now by the devilment of fucking Christmas, the latest addition to my list of dependents, a little white mouse whose reason for existence under my roof is yet to be explained to me.
I can explain that mouse, Father. It was a Christmas gift from Lottie.
There are no gifts! A gift is just a debt. Unwritten but implied. And this gift has a golden bell around his neck. Now you tell me, what good is gold to a mouse?
The bell wasn't real gold. Lottie took it from a toy. It was gilt and worth only pennies.
Yet still, that mouse, with his bell, is richer than I.
You could have taken that bell. Just cut the ribbon. You could have done it without causing any harm to him.
Harm to Vermin? Learn! Jesus! Listen! Feed only that which like some they feed you! Where is this mouse and its bell?
Not this. Not a repeat of this.
Why not this, Ebenezer Scrooge? When you've relived it 1,000 times!
Unprofitable affections.
A lesson you learned well. And I am here to make you unlearn it.
You are the spirit Marley told me about. The one who doesn't even care.
I am the canvas. It is you who paints the pictures.
I don't care for riddles. I am done. Your point is made. If it makes any difference, your visit has opened an old wound, barely ever healed. Congratulations. Now
If you don't mind, I should like to sleep.
You will not get down on your knees and beg me for absolution.
No. I am quite careless of myself. I count myself to sleep each night the same. One day the count will end, sir.
I have had men claw at my robes. Women soak my sleeves with their tears.
Well, perhaps you should claim a new robe against tax as a legitimate expense.
Tonight you will not sleep, Ebenezer Scrooge. I will not allow it. This is not a game of reason against fancy, Ebenezer. I will put hot tweezers to your soul and remove the splinters. I am gonna take you on a long journey, measured not in yards and miles, but in days and years.
I don't want to go anywhere.
You have no choice but to come with me, Ebenezer. Come with the ghost of Christmas past, who feels your heart beating.
Sherry, I drank in front of the fire, from the decanter which has been half full these 6 months. The maid, who I dismissed for idleness, must have slipped laudanum into it. I haven't touched a drop of the sherry since she left until now. There. That is what all of this is. Laudanum slipped into my wine by a vengeful maid. You are an opiate.
Come on.
I know those boys.
Time to go, children!
Jasper. And Wellington. And poor Horace, who died of consumption. Poor Horace.
Welcome.
We are now in a time before poor Horace was struck down. Your memory shapes me according to what time we're in. Same spirit.
Different Christmas. At this time in your life, I was your only friend.
Behold!
I swear, there was never a time in my life when I had a friend who looked even remotely like you. Look again. My God. You are Ali Baba.
Yes! How many nights you spend reading my stories undercover by candlelight, over and over, to escape from the pain of these years, the shame?
You're an illustration.
Correct!
That is to say, in truth, you too are also opium.
Have you ever ridden a camel before?
No, I've never ridden a camel before, nor have I ever had a conversation with a picture from a picture book.
Well, today you are doing both. Come.
Come where? I know this place.
Indeed you do. The Black Bridge boarding school.
I do not wish to come.
Why?
I vowed I would never set foot inside Blackbridge School ever again.
And yet you step back inside it every night? In your dreams? Your nightmares?
You know so much.
Everything. A spirit can know everything except the outcome. Come with me!
morphine.
Actually, his name is Valentine, but you know that. As an 11-year-old child, you escaped from hell on his back many, many times.
What good will it do for me to go back?
If you come back with me now, you may never have to go back into your nightmare ever again. And if the camel and I are merely poppy fumes, what harm can it do? Come. The day is drawing to a close. You are in the dormitory reading your book, lost in the Arabian Nights. You are 11 years old. You are alone. Come and see.
Why do we not leave footprints?
We are not here. What you see happened a long time ago. On a particular day.
What particular day?
Come, you will see.
Who will be there on this day?
You and one other. Be brave, Ebenezer. You have Ali Baba and Valentine at your side.
The other children have gone home for Christmas, yes?
Yes, you saw them leave.
I was the only child who had to board here over the Christmas holidays, because my father said...
What did he say?
One year he said there was pestilence in our street. Another, the house was flooded. Another, there was no room in the new house. Always I had to stay here. I know that man.
Ebenezer, you cannot hurt him. He's in the past.
Well, I see him.
Always you see him. Ever since those days, you see him when you close your eyes. The great Ali Baba seeks to enter your past. Enter the den of the 40 thieves. Can you remember the magical password from the book?
Of course I remember the magic password. Open sesame.
I warned you, Ebenezer Scrooge. This is not a game. Come. Into the truth. Open sesame. Ebenezer, look upon yourself. What would you say to him if you could?
Spirit, I should like to go home now. That is exactly what he would say to me. I should like to go home now. That was all I wanted then, to be with my mother and sister.
Watch. Ebenezer, it is I.
Good Lord, he can see you.
Just for a moment. Sometimes children, they can see spirits. Children that need to see.
I remember this.
I remember this very moment. In the stories, Alibaba always can do anything. I was praying to him to save me and come and take me from this place. And I swear, just for one moment, I looked up and I saw him just where you're standing. I thought he could save anyone.
You and I here for Christmas again, Scrooge. Well, don't worry. Of course, I won't expect you to sleep in here on your own. You'll be with me. Just like last year. Come on, get your things. Come on.
Enough. I should like to go home now.
Not yet. Wait.
Come on, why? Up.
Because this is the happy year.
Goodness.
Yes, I know.
Who is it?
It's my sister, Lottie.
What the hell does she want?
I show you this not to torture you, but to enlighten you. Look!
Lottie!
She cannot hear you, Ebenezer. You are here only to watch and learn.
Ebby tells me you're his sister. What do you want?
I've come to take my brother home.
What are you talking about? Ebenezer spends Christmas with me.
Not anymore. Things have changed.
Your father and I have a long-standing arrangement to keep Ebenezer here.
Ebby, go and wait outside. There's a carriage.
No.
Ebby, our father has left us. At last. Mother said you were to go home. Go on. Run ahead.
Now for the part you do not know.
No, Scrooge, stop! I order you to come back.
Stop!
Your help is not needed.
What?
Our father made my brother stay here at Christmas. In return for you waiving school fees. But I and my mother have finally managed to be rid of him. And your little arrangement regarding my brother is over. My brother will never return to this school ever again. And if you try to follow, I will shoot you. And in my defense, have my brother tell the parish everything.
Lottie, like a highwayman. She pulled a fucking gun. She rescued me.
A Christmas miracle. An act of love. Without the need for thanks. A gift which was not given, as a debt implied.
Come. Mother's brought a goose for us to pluck.
But you never saw her bravery. Never felt the warmth of her selfless compassion.
Go on, get him! She always told me I had to leave the school because we couldn't afford the fees.
You never told a living soul about what happened at his school. But your sister knew. She could not bear the thought of you spending another Christmas in hell. Forget ribbons and bells. That is the spirit of Christmas. But you were numb to her. Lost to all affection. You went home and had no more need
for Ali Baba and Valentine.
I never went home. The boy who left never returned. I counted myself the most outdone by a creature on Earth.
Just yesterday, Lottie's son came to invite me to dinner. And even he told me Lottie had always warned him to be patient with me because of a very old pain.
But spirits, consider this. This is proof.
Proof? Of what?
What happened to me here at this school? This excuses me. This explains me. And because it's all in the past, nothing can be done to remedy it.
So you require more than a mincing knife and warm gravy to soften your heart. You only see what your father did to you, not what your sister did for you. Let us go deeper.
And Marley anthracite coal mine in the country of Wales. One of your later commercial ventures, after you and Mr. Marley met the Corn Exchange, both buying up bankrupt businesses from men like your father. And this was one of your most profitable ventures.
Poor thing. He is pure air and fire.
Evidently, when William Shakespeare wrote that about a horse, he'd never see one put down a toll pit. Not much is pure down here.
I remember when we bought the mine, I tried not to think about the horses.
We made this place profitable by cutting down on the excessive use of oak timbers. Before you and Marley bought the mine, they had used timber quite extravagantly to support the roof. No harm could come to us because we're not here. But they are not so lucky. Recall, this was midnight on Christmas Eve. And this is a Christmas gift for 27 men and women and boys and multiple ponies. You try not to think about the horses, but did you ever think about the human souls?
Pull us up! In the name of God! Pull us up! In the name of God, the timbers won't roll! Save us! Save us! Pull us up! Save us!
The only thing you didn't count were the victims. They were lost in your darkness.
Spirit, where are we? Is this hell?
No, we are now back in your 30th year, Ebenezer Scrooge.
and business is booming.
Come. Come quick or we'll miss it.
I would just like to explain the Christmas mine collapse and its causes, which aren't at all how you characterize it.
There is no time for explanations. Yes, yes, it's Christmas Eve again. And yet they will all be working until long after dark. But come, Ebenezer.
I fear something awful awaits.
No, something magical. Something wonderful. Prophet, Ebenezer. Pure prophet.
Look, Scrooge, there you are. You and Marley in your prime. This was the moment when it all really began.
My father's barely called in his grave, and already you're here with business.
Well, your father looks down from heaven and urges you to listen to us.
Your father was fond of gambling on horses. Fond of it, but poor at it.
And we can't all choose a winner at the Epsom Derby.
We didn't know how much he'd lost until his last breath.
Look, grief blinds you, slows you. We're here to help you. We're familiar with some of the people of his secret acquaintance, and we're in a position to purchase your father's gambling debts. Owed to a turf accountant in Halifax, name of Dagger.
Why would you do that?
I'm afraid the price of slow horses are the least of his legacy.
Put that back.
Accounts not worth the paper they're written on. Money due to the government revenue, spent instead on some nag with the same name as his mistress.
How dare you?
Secrets, debts, mistresses. Revenue men who bring pistols and chains.
They can't train a ghost, young man. It will be you they throw into the lockup.
You wish to buy one loom?
No, the whole mill.
Well, I think you missed off a zero.
Zero means nothing, so we missed off nothing. Sit down. Now, we'll deal with Dagger. We also have friends at the revenue who will overlook your inherited liability in return for a healthy bribe, of course.
The mill itself is worth 10 times that.
The mill is healthy, but you have no liquidity. You need money now. Without us, it will be a race between Dagger's cutthroats and the revenue's militiamen.
Please know that your father's reputation as a pious Christian family man will be safe in our hands.
I'll even put up a plaque. There, above your head.
So your father can rest in peace. Now. Do we have a deal?
You bought this cotton mill in Dewsbury for £800, then promptly sold it 4 days later for £8,000 to be demolished and broken up for parts. You had discovered that tragedy for the many is opportunity for the few. 500 jobs lost and a profit of £7,200 in just 4 days for doing precisely nothing. You and Marley would become celebrated for deals like the splendid bit of opportunism you just witnessed.
It was business. I cannot be blamed for doing business.
You cannot be blamed for building your beautiful temple to profit, because profit means more and more and wonderful more. And you were very considerate. You didn't tell the workers they had all lost their jobs until Boxing Day.
Why do you mock me with false glory in your voice?
I am a spirit. I am what you make me. And your glory was real. Real cash, hard currency.
Was it so wrong to make a profit? To use that profit to make more profit?
No, nothing wrong at all. And every penny you made is still there inside your head. Behold, each loom shows another profitable year for the unstoppable Messrs. Scrooge and Marley. That is your fourth year of trading. What was your net income that year?
Year four. Net income, £665, 7 shillings and sixpence.
This is year 8. Total expenditure?
Expenditure year 8. £4,871.19. Mostly the acquisition of Denman and Sons and a wire factory in Birmingham.
This year, your 10th year.
Ah, an excellent year. A move into Spice and Indigo in the Moluccas. Income, £9,970.07. Expenditure.
All in your head. What a mind you have. You counted yourself the most hard done by boy in the world. And you counted and counted. Wherever you looked, you didn't see people. You saw pounds and pennies. The weakness of others spun into wealth. Your accounts were your new Alibaba. Profit, your new Valentine.
Ah, I forgot. You are mocking me. I have done no more and no less in my life than many an illustrious businessman.
Your life?
Did you say your life? Come and see your life.
Behold, your life beyond the counting machines.
Elizabeth.
The days she waited and waited.
I was kept late at the exchange. Who are they?
They are the children you would have had with Elizabeth. And there you are, the father you never were, being a merry-go-round for the children you never had. Behold, a Christmas past that never was and never will be. Humbug. How many Merry Christmases are meant and how many are lies? To pretend on one day each year that the human beast is not a human beast. Do you see any beasts up there, Ebenezer?
I would have called the children Jacob, Lottie, and neither would have been sent away to school. They would have come home safe every night.
Children who were never born bring emotion you never had. Not even for the children of people you knew intimately. I told you, my business is the intimate inspection of your heart and of your soul. So, come now, and we will witness how your blindness finally gave rise to the abominable. To something you did 7 Christmases ago.
7?
Come, Ebenezer, and look upon the evil that you did. An evil that was not even for profit. We are not men, and we are not here, and yet we witness where this awful thing began.
Your baby is born. Is it a boy or is it a girl?
Boy.
Does he breathe?
He breathes.
Is he whole? Mother, is he home?
Martha, is he whole?
And in this, moment, do you remember what you did?
No.
You looked upon the suffering, not of faceless strangers, but of people you've known for years. And in their anguish, you would see only one thing. Opportunity. Come with me to Christmas Eve, 7 Christmases ago. When the clock is striking 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
In the morning, and all is snowbound and ice.
Gretchen's an hour early.
Come in. May I speak with you in confidence, Mr. Scrooge?
Yes, I always have time for early risers. Is your husband ill? Are you here to make excuses?
No. My husband will be reporting for work in 1 hour as usual. Though to work on Christmas Eve is not so usual.
Oh, it's Scrooge and Marley, it is usual. What do you want at this hour?
As I think you know, 2 years ago, I gave birth to a boy, Tim. And as I also think you know, he was born with imperfections.
Yes. Perhaps too much rich food in your diet, Mrs. Cratchit.
This cold and the smoke in this city, it does not suit a boy so tender. He has fluid on his lungs. A surgeon has told us that he requires an operation, thoracic draining, or he will die. The cost of the operation is far beyond our means. It's very complex, in 3 stages.
How much?
10, 10 and 10. £30.
Can't sell your house?
The house is rented.
You have no rich relative.
Mr. Scrooge, my husband is too proud to ask you himself. But I weigh my pride against my baby's life, and the scales break with the imbalance.
You are a poet.
I am a mother in desperate need. And I came here without my husband's permission or knowledge to ask you, Mr. Scrooge, for a loan.
Where does your husband think you are?
What lie did you tell?
Well, I told him that I would queue for the best goose.
Ah, you can afford a goose, but you still want a loan?
You could deduct a certain amount from my husband's wages each week. I think we could survive on 2 shillings less. And over...
Shh, let me see. 2 shillings per week. 2 by 52, that's 104 shillings per year. That is £5, 4 shillings. £5, 4 shillings per year times 6 is £31, 4 shillings. So, if your husband were to continue to work for me, he would pay his debt in 6 years and provide an interest dividend of £1, 4 shillings.
Mr. Scrooge.
That's an interest rate of 4%, which on a 6-year investment is uncompetitive, especially since it depends on a guarantee of 6 years of service, when, as we know, life is filled with misfortune and unexpected hazards, which may render him unable to fulfill his obligation.
Mr. Scrooge, I think we might be able to survive on less per week.
If you were to sacrifice absurd things like goose at Christmas, yes, perhaps.
Mr. Scrooge. There is no one else.
Mrs. Cratchit, in my safe at present, I have £537.15, pure profit, pure. Just behind that iron door, which opens with the turn of this key. And the words, open sesame. What would you do, Mrs. Cratchit, to have me open that door and hand you £30? Not as a loan, but as a gift. I know, Mrs. Cratchit, you are a faithful, virtuous, and honest woman. But I'm curious as to the extent of that honesty and faithfulness. The price of it, I mean.
I do not understand what you mean, Mr. Scrooge.
Ten. 10 and 10. I am a man of reason, a scientist. I like to conduct experiments regarding the human condition, regarding virtue and vice. Experiments to determine if every aspect of the human soul can be converted into currency, and if so, what is the exchange rate for love, for example, or compassion. Mrs. Cratchit, please, take 10 now, then think up another lie to tell your husband and come to my apartments on Christmas Day at 4 p.m. When you're at my apartments, if you do exactly what I tell you to do, everything I tell you to do, I'll give you the rest as a gift.
Christmas Day itself would be difficult.
Christmas Day is a day like any other. Meet me in my apartments at 4 p.m. Do we have a deal?
Yes.
Spare a penny for the poor, madam, on this fine Christmas day.
And so it came to pass that on this Christmas day 7 years ago...
Why do I feel the cold? Why do I feel the cold if I am only here in spirit and not here in body?
The cold that you are feeling comes from within. from inside your soul. Before this moment, you couldn't feel it, but now you can.
Then if I am to become a compassionate and tender person, I will need thicker socks.
When real feeling returns, pins and needles will begin. Needles in your heart, pins to hold up pictures from your past. Come, follow poor Mary to her destiny and witness what you did. But remember, this is not about you, Ebenezer Scrooge. It is about her.
Christmas to you, madam.
I do not need to witness this. I do not need to be here. Drink?
No, please. Let's get this thing done. I said I'd be back for...
For what?
Pouring of the brandy on the pudding.
Ah, a perfect Christmas tradition. Pour perfectly good brandy onto an already cooked pudding and set fire to it. Thus burning the pudding and wasting the brandy.
To the moment.
And what is the moment? I need to be clear.
Our arrangement.
I need to be clear.
You will give me money if I allow you to do what you want.
And what do I want? I need to be clear.
I have to say it out loud.
Yes.
I imagine.
To be clear, you are willing to have intercourse with me in return for the £20 cash I have put on the fireplace, along with the 10 I put down as a deposit on your virtue.
In the name of God.
You would do it in the name of God?
For my son. As you know...
Yes. Yes, I know.
I do this only for the life of my child.
In truth, your reason for needing the money is not part of my experiment, and therefore not of interest to me. Everyone has their own reasons for wanting and needing money. That is not the issue. My experiment is about currency. It is about finding out the extent of the things a good person will do in return for money, and how much each bad thing would cost, thereby establishing a kind of exchange rate, a human exchange rate. Similar to the exchange rate on the commodity market. Except now, it is your virtue. Your virtue up for auction. And with it, any doubt in my mind about human nature. Going. Going. Interest in you, Mary Cratchit. Nor in anyone in this way anymore. The intercourse I sought was purely of the intellectual kind.
You are a devoted wife, a loving mother, and yet on Christmas Day, you are prepared to run across town in the snow
and break every solemn vow and commandment in return for money. Take it. You've already given me what I want. Proof. Merry Christmas.
Never speak of this.
I will never tell your husband. But if he should ever tell you he is thinking of leaving my appointment, the truth might slip. So I will count on you to urge caution to him as he considers his future career. I value your husband very highly. Now, go and burn your figgy pudding.
I will. And I will say a prayer. That someday, some power of justice will grab you by the throat and drag you to a true, bright mirror that you might see the truth in your reflection, and that the truth will be known to the world. I am a woman, and I have the power to summon such spirits, and I fucking will
Is it true? Was it Mary Cratchit who summoned you to take me by the throat?
Behold. Even yet. No pins? No needles. What care I about another?
Just remember, the money I gave to Mary Cratchit was used to save her son's life, and Tim lives still. So if you view virtue purely through the consequence of action rather than the motivation for the said action, we have just witnessed my former self doing a good thing.
Bravo! You are a rock, a pile of rubble. A heart lost, never to be found. The sun measures my allocation. My time with you is done.
So I am forgiven?
How many times must you be told? It's not about your forgiveness!
Well, what is it then? How am I supposed to find what I'm meant to find, or feel what you want me to feel, if I don't know what it is?
It is now midday. The second spirit will come when the clock strikes midnight. The second spirit will search the blizzard for your heart. And if it only finds rocks and ice, Ebenezer Scrooge, Peter!
Wait, tell me what to expect. Tell me what is expected of me. My thoughts are my own, but my soul is beyond my control. Spirit, tell me how to change it!
Spirit, is there hope? Has he changed? Spirit, speak! Please tell me the work you've done has managed to change him. I can't stay here for eternity. They're sending you.
Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas, one and all. Many benefits. Prosper. I mean you, Prosper, not me. Season's tidings, etc. Merry Christmas, one and all. On it goes, empty, false, enforced, year upon year, endlessly.
Peppy.
Spirit? Spirit?
You paid for my funeral, yet here I am. The ghost of Christmas present. A present unknown to you. Unknown to almost everyone.
till they're made to look. Come. Come on.
Lottie, if I'd known what you did for me all those years ago, I would have shown more understanding.
I will show. And you will learn. And hopefully, you will soon begin to feel. So you need to wrap up. You may recall that when I was alive, I was quite the scientist. Well, I still am. What I will show you is in the name of science. You like experiments, don't you? Any scientific study of human society will illustrate the success of that society is dependent upon the function of the collective. And the function of the collective is dependent on various discrete factors.
You know, Lottie, I once remarked that you were the brightest person I knew. Later, I remarked that you were also a bit of a show-off about it.
Now, just pay attention. Our first case study. It is Christmas morning. Not past, not future, but here and now. Not an easy time for Bob and Mary. Not much surplus for gifts for the children. Bob has taken Belinda's old ice skates and he's mending them so that she can skate on the pond on Christmas Day, as she loves to do. Mary's writing out a story that she was told as a child, from memory. She has an excellent memory. The story of Icarus. She's illustrating it for Tim so that she can give it to him.
And they have no money for books.
Tim will value this book more than any bought in a shop. And if you're worried about the ink, Bob offered to steal her some from your supply. But she refused. She didn't want anything in the house that had even been touched by Ebenezer Scrooge.
It's Christmas!
Oh, Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas!
Alright.
Happy Christmas.
Is this an experiment? To see if you can wring blood from my heart?
Present?
No, I'll show you this scene to comfort you.
Did you? No.
They have no money. But listen.
Oh, and that one's
for what they lack in money, they make up for with love.
Fruit and nuts! Yes!
The share, Belinda.
And you see the science of it?
Biscuits! Thank you.
Love makes them mend and draw and write, make do.
My ice skates!
Without love, they would demand more money for new skates and real books. Every Bob Cratchit in England survives half on money and half on love.
Are you going to go out with them today? Yes.
Yes?
This book. It's beautiful.
Be careful, it might still be a bit wet.
Thank you so much. For these.
Ebenezer. It is I.
Your dad was our whole life. So it is love. Love that saves the system from revolution. A scientific and economic reason for you to embrace it, Ebenezer. See the value of it.
You're mocking me.
You mock yourself. Putting a value to things that have no price. How many candles are there under the tree? And bells. How many bells? And presents for the children. How many were there? You didn't count. You stared for a long time, but you didn't count. Before, you counted everything. This time, you looked.
Is that a good thing? Is that progress?
You tell me.
I thought you were supposed to know it all.
Oh, do you smell that, Ebby? The day passes quickly already. It's dinner time.
It's a pleasure to have you.
And there's Goose.
Mary, as a lonely widow, I had a dozen invitations to dinner, and I'm mighty glad that I chose to accept yours.
Never a finer goose was seen.
And so cheap. It had a broken leg or a leg shorter than the other or something.
Bob, you carve.
After dinner, I'm going skating. I want to come.
Come
can't hardly walk. How will you skate?
Belinda, please.
Belinda. I will skate someday.
You will, but if you read my book, you'll learn how to fly.
Will we have figgy pudding this year?
Eat your dinner first, Belinda.
Of course we'll have figgy pudding. It's already in the copper.
And will we pour brandy on it and set light to it?
Yes, but you'll have the bit without the brandy.
Wasn't there a year when we had to go out and miss the brandy being poured?
When was that?
Really? That's a shame.
Come on, Dad. I'm starving.
Yeah, me too.
Tim?
Thank you.
Thank you. Look at that. Did you help, Belinda? Tim?
I plucked the goose.
The absence of money, the family can survive. The absence of truthfulness, they cannot.
Mary.
I'm fine. Please go and carve.
You said we discussed the source of the money half.
How? It's as though the whole issue is somehow with us in this house.
I need to tell you, Bob. I want to tell you
please,
the truth. No, I can't stand.
Mom, Martha's trying to carve and she's making
go, Belinda.
Hurry up.
I want to tell you where I got the money for Tim's operation.
It's as if she can see me.
Sometimes in high emotions, they see spirits.
Mary, if you want to tell me the truth here and now, please, go ahead and do it. And before the goose goes cold.
The truth is, there is no rich cousin in America. I made him up. That Christmas Day, I went to Margaret Henderson, Lady Henderson. You remember her, the one who lost her mind? I remembered when I worked for her. She had so many diamonds that she never wore. I asked if I could have a pair of her earrings.
Why is she lying?
To spare the day.
What?
To spare her loving husband. She was old and she was confused. And for all she knew, I might as well have been asking for a ginger biscuit. She said, yes, take them. I took the diamonds from her jewelry box and I sold them. So, here I stand before you, your wife, the jewelry thief. That is how I got the money.
Moment of truth is the best Christmas present I've ever had. I have something to tell you. All of you. Come. Everyone, I have some news. Cratchit tribe, one and all, your father has something to tell you.
Bob, let's eat first.
I know this news will help with our digestions.
What news? Can we eat while we listen?
Hush, Belinda.
I wish to announce I've made a decision about my career. I've decided that Monday morning, December 26th, that's tomorrow, I'm going to go into the office, and I'm going to hand in my resignation notice to that old skinflint, Ebenezer Scrooge.
Yes!
And Mary, don't be alarmed. I've received an alternative offer, you see, by Mr. Thwaites. Thwaites and Langley. He was quite disgusted by some of the things Scrooge said to him on the street. He sent me an offer. And the best part is my Christmas gift to the whole family. In my new position, I will be receiving 2 extra shillings every week.
2 shillings?
So next year there will be brand new ice skates for you, Belinda, and there will be real wings for you, Tim.
Thank you.
Bob, congratulations.
Well done, that's
very good. Mary. You of all people hate Scrooge. And when I leave, we'll be free of him.
We will never be free of him.
What do you mean?
Enough. We will get Christmas done, Bob. And we must speak again.
Mary.
We will get Christmas done!
There. The happy family, silenced by your experiment.
I want her to know that if Bob Cratchit resigns, I will say nothing about what happened. I want to tell her that
no,
right now.
No, she already feels your presence. We need to leave.
Get out of my house. Get out of my house. Get out of my house!
And behold Ebenezer, the bruised and broken body of Christmas Day, seen with your own eyes. Now listen, this very Christmas morning, in a valley far away, they are singing. Christmas Day memorial service for those who lost their lives in your great Drakelofter pit disaster. What do you see?
I meant to see.
No tears. No self-pity. You see men and women and children united.
Train to London every Christmas Eve to pay his respects at Jacob Marley's grave.
He lost his father and 2 brothers to your economies.
Hi. My goodness. The feelings you instill are terribly strong.
Given my time again, I would not reduce expenditure on Simba. Given the time again, I would not be myself.
There. The first pin, the first needle.
Brave ponies who perished in the earth on Christmas Day in the morning.
Do you remember Flash? The black horse I rode to school before I sent away.
Yes.
And then when I went away, Father sold him. Just as when I was a boy, he sold me.
Ebenezer, my time with you is almost done. Please speak of it.
I am feeling regret.
It comes to me like a lump in my throat, a lump of rock in my throat. Regret. That is a start, isn't it? I should have thanked you. Taking me out of that school.
Where I now know I was part of a bargain done between a schoolmaster and our father. My father. My own father. There. Said out loud. Saying it conquered it, I would shout it. It doesn't. Lottie, I should have loved you. But I want you in all the world to understand. Came with your carriage and your gun. Too late. That is what I will say is my defense.
Ebenezer, when the next spirit comes, please don't offer him excuses. He's the terrible one. The unknown one. And the one who decides. He has no interest in the past.
Lottie.
Only what lies ahead. Go back inside. He'll be waiting.
Lottie.
Goodbye, dear brother.
I couldn't love you. future. Spirit. I understand. You are the spirit of Christmas future. And because we can never know the future, you are not allowed to speak. Here is this.
Dear Mr. Scrooge, this letter is to inform you that I am, as of this day, offering my resignation. So he's doing it, he's resigning. Before I leave, I wanted you to know that you are the most unpleasant, devious, inhuman.
Dad, come. It's Tim. There's been an accident.
When? How?
He went to the pond. He borrowed my ice skates. But he didn't tell anyone. Nobody was with him.
My sister said it is you who decides. Are you deciding now?
Is it in your power to change things? Because if it is, I can change things, Hal. You mean if I had my time again? Well, then give it to me. I know I don't deserve a second chance, but I understand now what it is I must... Tim?
Tim! If you can hear me, you must live! You must stay awake, Tim! For your mother!
I hear little man. Stay with us.
I don't care about the rules!
We're here, little man.
Don't leave us, Tim! Tim, no!
What year is this? What year do I die? But it is Christmas. No mourners, just worldly goods. But actually, Spirit, I don't care. I don't care what will become of me. My fate. And you know my question. What happened to Tim Cratchit? No matter what, nothing sinks them. Not even death. Nothing makes them question because they have.
need to know why. What was the reason for all of this? Why did your spirits come to me? Why did you show me all of this? What purpose?
I'm not sure what the reason is, Ebenezer, but I know the purpose. It's all to do with redemption and our joint liability. All three spirits have done their work. I asked them to let me have a final try. We were so, so wrong. Admit that, at least.
No. No, I refuse. I refuse to change. All their efforts were for nothing because I refuse redemption.
In God's name, Ebenezer, why?
This fate, this piss-covered second-class grave, is exactly what I deserve. And if redemption were to result in some kind of forgiveness, I do not want it. Because I would find a way to justify everything I have done according to the consequence. Because that's who I am. The only thing. The only thing I want the spirits to do, the only change I want them to make, is to spare the life of him.
Feel what?
At the moment, a pain in my ass. Oh, ouch. Yes.
I was meaning to sprinkle this on the ice earlier. What with it being Christmas, I forgot.
Yes. Yes. Everything in life is a lesson if you care to know. The sprinkling of gravel on ice is an action taken by a person for the benefit of others without expectation of any reward of any kind. A whole new philosophy on human nature encapsulated in a handful of gravel.
Did you hit your head?
Forgive me.
Merry Christmas, sir.
It is. It is, yes. Merry Christmas, sir. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas to you. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. This I will gladly do.
Merry
here this Christmas.
Mary, as a lonely widow, I had a dozen invitations to dinner, and I'm mightily glad that I chose to accept yours. Never a pine and goose was seen.
And so cheap. It had a broken leg or a leg shorter than the other or something.
Bobby, you carve.
I'm going skating. I want to come.
You can't hardly walk. How will you skate?
Belinda, please.
I will skate someday.
Expecting company, Martha?
I wouldn't presume.
Good.
Yes, I know. Unwanted presumption. But on this day...
What are you doing here?
But this day, this I must do. I have three things I need to say.
Get out of my house.
One, two, three, and then I will go. Item number one.
I said
item
leave.
Number one is I know you are planning to hand in your resignation tomorrow.
Well, what's he talking about?
I want you to know that you leave with my blessing. Yes, blessing.
How do you know I'm planning on handing in my
resignation? I just know. And you are retiring at a very appropriate time because... Tomorrow morning, I am closing the company down.
You need to leave my house.
Scrooge and Marley will trade no more in this world. And as a gesture of goodwill, my final item of company business is
you
to...
You need to leave my house?
..is to draw up a cheque for £500, made payable to you by way of thanks for your service. So, new ice skates for you, Belinda, and more books for you, Tim.
Mum. How do you know about my ice skates?
I know these things because I've been showing them by spirits. This is item number two, by the way. I have been visited by spirits who were summoned by someone to grab me by the throat and drag me to a bright mirror so that I might see the truth.
Mr. Scrooge, have you been drinking?
Not yet, but later I will. I will drink a toast, indeed, to fathers and mothers and children and whoever you are at home together for Christmas. Item number three, regarding children. Item three, Belinda, the pond where you love to go skating is no longer in use. It has been rendered unusable. Tim, you will not go skating. You will stay at home, you will read your book, and you will learn to fly instead.
Is this what happens when someone drinks laudanum?
No, this is what happens when someone finally understands. Made to understand what it is to be human. That is all. Thank you. The check will be delivered by hand. Christmas. Merry Christmas.
I'll show you out.
Mary.
It's fine. I do not know what's happened to you. And I don't care. Your £500 will be welcome. But it will not buy forgiveness.
Nor shall forgiveness ever be earned, nor expected or wanted. My business now is the future. I will just be the best I can be. For the spirit and the bright light and the mirror, I thank you.
Why the camels in the snow?
spirits, past, present, and future. There is still much to do.